A very good afternoon to all the dignitaries on and off the rostrum. I, Tanveen Kaur Bedi, takes immense pleasure to introduce Mr. V. Suresh, Chief Sales Officer, Naukri.com. Mr. V. Suresh has completed his MBA in Sales and Marketing from Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. He has also attended Management Development Programs in Leadership at the Wharton Business School. Mr. Suresh has 20 years of work experience in sales, product management, and sales leadership. Sir started his career with Xerox Limited and was associated with Xerox for over 5 years. Sir joined Naukri.com in 2002 as a regional head for South Region and currently is a chief sales officer at Naukri.com. Sir is an academic advisor for Institute of Technology and Management, Chennai. Sir is also a board member of Jensen School of Head of Business, Coimbatore. It's an honor to have you, sir. Now I request you to share your words of wisdom. The podium is all yours.
This place reminds me of, I think, 2004 or 2005, when I had come to this campus to hire people from your campus. I have a huge task at hand. One, after a heavy lunch, keeping you awake. Also about, after all the eminent speakers who have spoken, it's kind of really tough to keep you awake. How many of you actually had a chance to sleep before 12 o'clock last night? Not bad. Okay. Before we get in, let's do a small exercise. Okay. This exercise actually, once you do the exercise, I will tell you why we do this exercise. I need a volunteer. Someone, yeah, please come. And I need a stopwatch, if you can put a stopwatch in your mobile. So we will do this exercise for 75 seconds. What we need to do is once I say go, take your right thumb, press it onto your left palm. Okay. You have to close your eyes. Don't go off to sleep. Okay. I can be rest assured that once you get off from there, for the next 60 minutes, even if you want to sleep, you can't sleep. Okay. I can challenge. Okay. Okay. What you do is think about, listen to what I'm going to say very carefully. Think about the most beautiful moment of your life so far. You all have done this exercise before? You've not done this before? You have to actually take yourself back to that minute, to that day, to that moment when somebody complimented you for having achieved a gold medal. Somebody complimented you for maybe performing extremely well in, you know, sports, games, whatever. Okay? So, what you need to do is to kind of feel what's happening to your body, what's happening to your mind, what's happening to your thought. While you're doing this, constantly be aware of what's happening to you. And definitely I'll pick up a few people to kind of share what you went through. And this is, when you do this again, I'll share with you what this could probably be the single most takeaway for you from my entire 60-minute session. What you're doing now could probably be useful for you 50 years from now, 20 years from now. Right? Are we in? Start. 75 seconds sharp. Okay, time up. Any of you, what happened? Any volunteer who can share? Anyone? Please take the mic to the person whomsoever wants to share. Yeah, please. Just tell me, how are you feeling right now? Superb. Why? Why are you feeling? If any of you are not interested, I would recommend probably you can help others by moving out of this room.
Very good afternoon. So basically, I went on to a situation where my family members were there. I was on the podium with a medal. And the charm on my parents' face was something that I loved.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Now, what is the feeling? How are you feeling now?
So to express, it's beyond words, first of all. I feel grateful, I feel happy, I feel proud. Yeah, that's
amazing. What's your name?
Sumit Saxena.
Sumit Saxena. Give a big hand to him. Very good. Beautiful. Anyone else? What's the feeling? I have seen such energy from this place. You should look at Bala sir for energy. And I'm asking one volunteer and you're not able to raise your hands. I can't imagine. Yeah, please.
I basically saw my parents while I graduated with good percentage and I cleared my professional exam. So the charm that my parents had, a sense of accomplishment was there. I felt content that yes, I could give them certain level of satisfaction which is needed at that point of time.
Beautiful. What's your name?
Naba. Naba.
Naba, N-A-B-A.
Yes, sir. N-A-B-A.
Well done. Anyone else who wants to share? Otherwise, I'll go on with my inferences of why I did what I did. Why did I do this? What else? What has happened to us right now? You have actually created a new present for yourself. You have created a new present for yourself. All the problems, all the tension, all the anxiety that you had, or whatever the overdose of information that you had from the morning, lack of sleep. Some people are sitting here, maybe didn't have your lunch. Maybe you have a worry that you have an assignment to be submitted tomorrow. So many things are happening to you right now. Somebody is ill in your family. Something else is happening. As in, at the end of the day, you are a human being. Let's not forget that we are not robots. We have emotions. Something happened to you, good, bad, ugly, whatever, and you're sitting in this room. As leaders in corporate life, day in and day out, when you walk into work at 9:30 and when you come out of work at 6:30, you don't keep your anxiety at home and go. You do carry that anxiety at home. When you come back, you carry work back home. What differentiates successful leaders? What differentiates normal human beings to super normal human beings? What differentiates a manager to a leader? Why is this exercise that I did, which is important? Because in the world today that we live, we are living in what is called the nanosecond 90s. This is what a prof who visited our campus in 96, he said, we are living in nanosecond 90s, the only permanent thing is change. We are running a marathon. We are actually running on a treadmill. The world around you is changing so fast that you can't even imagine. You can't even imagine that a company like Yahoo could be acquired by Verizon at 4 point. In 1996-97, Yahoo had a chance to buy out Google, sorry, for about 1 billion, 2 billion. Yahoo's market capitalization was 44 billion. There was an offer for 44 billion from Microsoft. Just a matter of 16 years, they're down to nothing. Pagers, how many of you have seen pager? SMS, pagers are out of business. In 96, I had a pager when I was in Xerox. SMS is out of action after WhatsApp. Emails are going down the drain after WhatsApp. It just, you use emails only for attachment. Otherwise, you don't need email today. This is the place that we are in today. Life is changing so fast. Whatever skills and competencies which are relevant in 2000 aren't relevant today. 2000 to 2010, that decade was a decade of internet. 2010 to 2020, the decade of mobile phones, apps. 2020 to 2030 would be Internet of Things, what is called IoT. So as leaders, as management professionals, you all have to keep constantly updating yourself about what's happening in the technology, what's happening on the leadership space. And also, I'm not going to dwell too much about technology here. What I'm going to dwell upon is a very interesting subject. I'm not sure whether all of you can see the slides because lights are fully on. If you can't, please let me know. What I'm going to talk about is what is called the leadership success journey. What are the secrets of success? What is actually success? What is success? Anyone, what is success? How do we define success? Yeah, please. Beautiful. Excellent. Doing something that you're passionate about and doing something better than yesterday, constantly improving. Success, beautiful definition. What else is success? Pardon? Achieving your goal, beautiful. Dream, achieving your dream. Yes. Amazing, you're getting into SQ, which is called spiritual quotient. Beautiful, very good. So success means many things to many people. For a kid who's in LKG, getting a toy also is success. He's got something from his dad. In school, getting admission. If you're in 10th standard and you're looking for getting an admission into 11th standard, you would say, if I'm getting an MPC group, that's a big achievement. Getting a dream college, dream institute. Sitting here, it's a big achievement. You are here, that's a big achievement. Once you've got into a college, then get into PG. Got into PG, getting into a job. Somewhere, I think the definitions of success are about something that you want to dream about, you're passionate about. You want to pursue medicine, you want to pursue management, you want to pursue whatever, law. What are we emphasizing on? We are emphasizing on mathematics, we are emphasizing on vocabulary, grammar, science, physics, chemistry, biology, accounting, management accounting, cost accounting. So somewhere, all these skills which you currently study, these are the ones that will enable you, the knowledge that you gain enables you to success. So in B school, they will say, okay, fine, if you're getting 9.5 out of 10, if you get a gold medal, you're a successful B school student, successful engineer. Are these skills, is this a sufficient prerequisite? Yes. But will this get you what? What will this get you? This will get you a spot in the interview table. That's all. What do I use your marks for? Am I using your marks to select? I'm using your marks to reject. Marks, I'm again standing in a management institute, I'm not demeaning marks. Marks are extremely important. 100,000 people got 10 out of 10 CGPA in CBSE 10th standard this year. Can you imagine? 100,000 people got 10 out of 10 CGPA in CBSE board this year. That is the level of competition at which the world is moving. All of you sitting in this room are extremely smart, that's why you're here. You're smart in some way or other, not just in marks. To deserve a seat in this institute, you've done something different. What will that take you to? My question is, if I have to kind of use, are all IIT IIMs earning the best packages? Are they the CEOs? Are they doing extremely well everywhere? Ideally, if I have to go by the kind of filtration that happens in IIT and IIM, I think every single person who passes out from these institutes should be possibly getting the best paying jobs. But that doesn't happen. Why? I'm asking you provoking questions. Not that I'm saying IITs and IIMs are bad. Beautiful. Attitude. I'm not saying they're good, bad. I'm just saying marks get you to a table where you can come for an interview. You may get selected because you performed well in GD, you performed well in interview, you did a good, you know, you did well in psychometric tests, whatever, whatever. Are they good enough to succeed in corporate life? Am I saying this? Or is data saying this? What is the data tells me? Today we have 4,165 people in our company. We have 10 plus brands. We are 800 crore plus turnover. We are probably the only internet company in India to have got listed in the stock exchange. 1,000 crore plus in the bank. Probably rated by almost all parameters as the number one job site in India today with 73% traffic share. I have over 200 plus engineers. Out of that, 160 plus are from IITs and RECs and whatever you call it. But if I look at the top 30 people in the company, less than 40% of them are from the so-called Tier 1 institutes. Why? Why do we have people who are from ordinary institutes? I'm not saying ordinary institutes means they're not good. At least as per the recruiters today, what they use, their filtration criteria. These are not the premium whatever institutes. And we have some of these guys doing extremely well compared to their peers. If I look at my own classmates who went to IIT, my own classmates who went to IIM, I didn't go to IIT, I didn't go to IIM. Yes, I went to Wharton, I went to ISB later. Those guys are not earning the money that I'm earning. Those guys are not having the kind of roles that I have. They are not even having the kind of opportunity that I have today. And I'm not boasting about myself. If I look at all my peers, whether it's a CTO of Naukri or whether it's a CPO of Naukri or whether it's a CMO of Naukri, I can talk about all of them. Why? What differentiates? How are successful people, how are successful organizations, how are successful leaders different? Pardon? Willpower, beautiful. Risk-taking ability, amazing. Out of the box. You have the answers. Come again. Learning ability. Pardon? Dare to think differently, out of the box, lateral thinking. Name it whatever way you want. Innovative. What I have done for the next 1 hour, I will kind of try and give you some tips. I thought about when this topic came to me from Bala sir, I thought about many things. Whether should I speak about technology, should I speak about emerging trends in the internet business, should I speak about what is happening in the global, you know, economic scenario, what is likely to make an impact to you? Because all these gyans are available in Google. You go and do a search in Google, you may even get a PowerPoint presentation readily available today. But what is not available today is, in fact, Balasar told me also, which is what I want to kind of emphasize on. How do you set your expectations right? How do you come into terms with the reality? I mean, the first question that he asked me when I met him is, what is the job market now? This is the question that I always people ask me. Whenever I'm in a flight, I kind of resist to even introduce myself to the guy who's sitting next to me, because after 5 days, I'll get an email from him saying, Suresh, I'm looking for a job. I kind of resist giving my visiting cards to anybody, because somehow or other, somebody wants to look for a job and an email will come to me and I'm in no position to help anybody, because we are not a recruitment firm. We cannot place people, we are a media. So typically when he asked me, I said, IT is looking bleak. This is not a good news for all of you. But this is the right news for all of you. IT is looking bleak. IT services or companies are not going to hire as many people as they hired in the last 4 or 5 years because of automation. Because of various things that are happening. So does that mean that are we bad as we were in 2008 during the Lehman crisis, subprime crisis? No, we aren't. So as students, aspiring students, waiting to kind of, you know, fly from this campus, looking for job opportunities in the market, what is it that you need to imbibe? Constant improvement on skill set. Beautiful. Collaborative thinking, amazing. I think I don't need to even make a PPT. I could have just asked all of you and I could have written it down. Beautiful. Collaborative thinking, attitude, willpower. What? Curiosity to learn. Innovative ideas. I think I would say adaptable. Don't look for salary, look for role. Money will come to you. If you go behind money, it will go farther away from you. There could be many startup companies. I mean, same time last year, there were so many startups which came to campuses and paid fancy salaries. Some of them shut up shops in 6 months. Some of them are looking for funding. Some of them don't know whether they can pay salaries for the next month. Some of them are acquired, some of them are non-existent. So look at the brand, look at the performance of the brand, look at whether they have, you know, you are management students, you can understand balance sheets. I mean, though you may be a marketing student, it doesn't mean that you will not understand basic balance sheets. Financial accounting is taught in first semester, if I'm not wrong. Right? Management accounting in second semester, cost accounting in third semester. Right? Cost and management accounting in one semester, whatever. So you at least know financial accounting and cost accounting and management accounting. You at least know balance sheet. You know what to read in a balance sheet. Right? So when you look for a job, look at the fundamentals of the company. Look at the founders. Look at the background. Look at which company has funded. Look at what was the career growth of the people who joined this company over the last 10 years, or last 5 years, or last 4 years. What kind of, don't go just by the fact that, you know, somebody is paying me 7 lakhs, somebody is paying me 5 lakhs. You may get 5 lakhs, but will your salary grow over the next 3, 4 years? Or will you be 5 lakhs only for the next 5 years? How do you know that? Right? So, your first job, the decision that you make right now is extremely critical. Rolling stone gathers no moss. If you are joining a company with an expectation that 1 year from now I will look for other job, and if you are joining sales thinking that, okay, I will join sales, I will go to marketing, and then I will go to product, I will do something else, then you don't learn anything in the process. So your decision making is extremely important. What kind of decision that you are going to make for yourself? And how are you going to make the decision? What analytics are you going to use? What kind of preparation are you going to go? Who's your peer group? Who's your ecosystem? Who are your sounding boards? Who are the people who are actually the influencers who help you take the decision? These are some of the things that I would want to touch upon. Goal orientation. Success in life, having a goal, having a target, having a mission. I asked Miss Beatty when she was coming, I said, what do you want to do 5 years from now, 10 years from now? I asked the other gentleman, Piyush, what do you want to do? He said, I'm in HR. What do you want to do in HR? Do you want to do recruitment? Do you want to do general HR? Do you want to do analytics in HR? If you are saying I'm in sales and marketing, what do you want to do? Do you want to do sales? Do you want to do product management? Do you want to do marketing? What in marketing do you want to do? When will you decide this? Right now. Basis which you will choose your electives, basis which you will choose your internships, basis which actually you will make an effort to get the right company for internship. So that every single decision that you take today, all have to actually, the means to the end, your end is to reach wherever you want to reach. Like for example, I was sitting with my area manager who's spent, let's say, 6-7 years in our company in Bombay, 2 weeks back. I asked him, what do you want to do? He said, sir, I want to start a company in 2 years. This guy is fresh out of some management school. I was happy to hear that. I was happy to hear that somebody who has worked only for 6-7 years with us didn't even have enough funds, not coming from a well-to-do family, but he had a thought in his mind that he wants to start something on his own. All I'm asking you is, get your goals right. This is not the time you can say, you know, I will experiment. Why do you think a Virat Kohli is more successful? Why do you think a Sachin Tendulkar is more successful? Discipline. The ability to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning and go for practice. Believe me, when you have a goal and when you have the perseverance to follow the goal to the last extent. First, get your goals right. And the goals are to be realistic goals. Don't have an ambitious goal which is impossible to achieve. Then you will be banging against your wall because it's unachievable. So you need a peer group, you need a sounding board to kind of work towards the proper goal. And when you take ownership on a target, let me tell you, this starts from right now. For example, if you commit, saying I'm going to submit this assignment on XYZ date, I want to do this on XYZ date, please ensure that you submit those on those specific dates, time-bound targets. If you, If you have a reputation which is built that you will be punctual, you will be disciplined. I mean, she was again talking today. What do you like about the Balaji? Sir, the discipline. I think she articulated the Balaji Society's culture in beautiful words in less than 15 minutes of our travel. I like the concept. She said, discipline is something that I picked up, sir. You can't teach discipline. That has to be imbibed. It's a culture. And that culture comes from the top. So to me, develop an attitude of having a goal. It could be a short-term goal. Align these goals to your personal goals. Your professional goals and personal goals have to be aligned. For example, if you say that your parents, like for example, yesterday I was in a B school again in Delhi, and I asked one of them saying that, you know, what brings you here? And this girl stood up and said, sir, my father once told me that you will go do an MBA and take me abroad for a foreign trip. So I think all of you are sitting here, you might have paid I don't know how many lakhs to reach here, but your parents have so much expectations from you that they want to see you flying in different colors. They have expectations from you. So there is a professional target that you want to become whatever, marketing manager, sales manager, brand manager, technology specialist, whatever. There is also a personal goal that you want to buy a house or you want to buy a car or you want to help your sister get married or whatever. At the end of the day, we are human beings. You have emotions. You have a family to take care of. So can you use your short-term and long-term goals, marry those professional goals to personal goals so that you can have a life after 6:30? Why do you think we all work very hard from 8:30 to 6:30, 8:30 to 7? We all slog because we want to go and have a beautiful life after office. That's the most beautiful life. Now, if you don't really marry both, the personal goal and professional goal, somewhere you don't even know why you are doing what you are doing. I will repeat this again. Why you are doing what you are doing? Ask this question to yourself many times. You are chasing something. You don't know the purpose of that chase. If you can't connect to that purpose of that, you will definitely not be able to align to it. You are doing an MBA because my dad told me to come for an MBA. Or I have a business and I'm going to go and run the business and, you know, it's required for me. An MBA degree is required for me to get a dowry. An MBA degree is required for me to do this. If this is the kind of a goal, then let's publish that goal and say this is my goal. Because then don't disturb others. They have other purposes for which they have come here. So get your goal right. Once you have known what your goals are, this is true for leaders, this is true for students, this is true for me. Even today, the most important thing I actually keep doing is, how do I prioritize my time? How do I plan my day? When she told me, sir, your session is at 2:30, I said, 10:30 is my flight landing. I need 2 hours to work. Can you give me the 2 hours? I was very clear that these 2 hours, I'm going to do my job. And these 2 hours are critical for me because if I don't work today, I'm going to work on Saturday. I'm going to take my family time away if I don't do this. So how many of you today are working on this quadrant which is called urgent and most important? Urgent and not important. All your WhatsApps, all your stupid calls that come to you from all your friends are time wasters. How many of you know your strengths? How many of you know your derailers? Let me tell you the difference between a successful leader, a successful student, and an average student is not skill or competency. It is about his ability to prioritize. If I actually do a psychometric test, most of you may score probably a similar kind of scores in many areas. But why somebody gets a 10 and why somebody gets a 6? Prioritization. Lack of prioritization. Or prioritizing on wrong areas. Again, I am telling you, when you leave this institute and go out, all the pampering that gets done will be knocked off. Day one, you come to my office, I'm going to treat you as an adult. How many of you have read this book called I'm Okay, You're Okay by Eric Byrne? parent ego state, child ego state, adult ego state. Read this book if you have not read it. Read books. Another suggestion to you, tip to you, at least read one book a week. Eric Burns, I am okay, you are okay. I am going to treat you as an adult when you step into my office. I am not going to talk to you on a parent ego state. I am going to talk to you on an adult ego state. And I expect you to respond not as a child ego state. Sir, ye nahi hua, wo nahi hua, puncture hua, car nahi hua. If you give excuses for not meeting your numbers, not meeting your objectives, this is not a campus. There is no second chance to make the first impression. Professional life is professional life. The discipline that you get inculcated here is actually preparing you for something which is war outside. In business world, day in and day out, we are on wars. Battle, war. When I say battle and war, it's real battle. One mistake I make in one pricing decision, in one strategy decision, one wrong hire, gone. That's you know, business is cruel. It doesn't give you a second chance. Let me tell you, life outside is not easy. Prepare yourself for the worst. Be ready for the worst. Prioritize, prioritize, prioritize. Know your goals. Don't waste your time with wrong people. ABC, always avoid bad company. If I look at spiritual parlance, Trikarana Shuddhi is what is called in Sanskrit. Your ability to harmonize your thought, word, and deed. If you want to be successful, if you want to be a great leader, if you want to get good marks, if you want to succeed, believe me, ensure you have the right food that goes in. What is called again in spiritual parlance, sattvic food. What is sattvic food? It is not the sattvic food that you eat. What you read, what you hear, your company of good people ensures that you are in the right shape. What you are going to be 5 years from now is determined by the books that you read, the people whom you are in touch with, and the kind of input that you give. So the thought becomes the word becomes the deed, and the deed becomes action. That's called Trikarana Shuddhi. I am again and again advising you, ensure that you have a daily calendar, weekly calendar, monthly calendar, timetable, follow it, basic. It is not rocket science. Success is not rocket science. Sachin Tendulkar, Vinod Kambli. We know both of them. Vinod Kambli, in fact, was a stylish left-hander. Had great skills. What differentiated? Attitude. The ability to work hard. Consistency. This is what Sachin is. Sachin as a brand is. What is Rahul Dravid? What is VVS Lakshman? Why do we call him the wall? Rahul Dravid is called the wall. Consistency. Every ball, I don't know, I will talk a lot about cricket because there's so much to learn from cricket when you look at management philosophy. Not only cricket, you look at any sport. Look at Deepika Padukone, look at Priyanka Chopra. Why are they so successful? Do they talk about work-life balance? The way she travels, Quantico, here, dance party, whatever. How is she able to create that energy with her? Why? Priority. She knows success means this. Discipline, ability to control herself. Again, all of you can be extremely successful if you inculcate this discipline, this quadrant. Every time you get into action, which quadrant is it in? Mentally start making those models. If I'm going to spend next 4 hours on something, which quadrant is this going to be in? Is it going to help me in long term, short term, or it's a time waster? How many of you waste your time on Facebook? What is the average time wasted in Facebook? 5 hours? That is the biggest time waster. Fit for useful, you know, useless time waster. Maybe you will do some learning out of this. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Keep all this away for the next 2 years. You can learn something from this. I'm not denying it. I was talking to them about the pros and cons of being on Facebook and pros and cons of being on LinkedIn and Twitter and how today brands are being, you know, you are a personal brand. What you speak in Facebook, what you speak in these, all these are, today there are technologies which can actually crawl all this information and put it on. We use this. When we do senior management hiring, we do all this. We look at the profile of the guy and look at what he has spoken in public domain. And select or reject him based on what he's been spoken or what people speak about him. So be careful. You guys are actually building brands. You accept every third person's invite on Facebook, not even knowing who he is or who she is. So be careful about prioritization. I'm saying prioritization should actually become a part and parcel of your daily life. It should be the DNA of you. You should say, fine, no, I will avoid this temptation. I will avoid this temptation. I will avoid. Successful people fail on one wrong decision, tehelka. I don't want to name that person. One wrong decision. CEO of a big IT services company. One wrong decision. You know who he is. I don't want to name him. You are in such situations where every decision that you take would have larger than life impact. Hard. This may sound so stupid, this may sound so silly, and say, do you have to fly down from Delhi to Pune to say I have to work hard? I don't have to, but I keep saying this and people find it difficult to accept it. I am very smart. I will do smart work. All of you are smart, that's why you are here. Why do you think Bala sir is so energetic? I haven't seen him. I saw him 2004. I have seen him in 2010 and today also. He travels 15 days a week. He is in every place going and what? Marketing, branding, selling the institute in some form or other to recruiters and to get us to this place. Why did I come here? Just because he wrote one mail. Why did he take that step? Why is he working so hard at this level? If I look at my vice chairman, he owns the company. I don't think I can match up to him in his ability to work hard. And I will tell you a joke. Whenever I go to my freshers, who are, you know, we call them management trainees, sir, how do I manage my work-life balance? What are you? What have you achieved in life? I've arrived. I have finished my MBA. I have joined naukri.com. No, I have arrived in life. Actually, you have arrived in nowhere. You have to unlearn, you have to relearn. We spend 18 months in what we call as on-the-job training. We do what is called cutting the diamond and making it into an ornament. When you come out of an institute, you come out of as diamonds. Now I have to make an ornament out of you. I have to see whether you are Sachin Tendulkar or you are MS Dhoni. What is the difference between Tendulkar and Dhoni? One is a born captain. One will never become a captain because he doesn't have it in him. Please excuse me, I'm not against Tendulkar, but he doesn't have it in him to become a captain. But he's a great batsman. So some, when you join, we use 24 months to figure out whether you are going to be a leader or whether you are going to be a solo performer and do a fantastic job in account management and other stuff. So the point here is, if you say, I'm a gold medalist, fine. I'm from IIM, I'm from IIT. All your past goes for a toss. Once you have joined a job, level playing field. You are taking a fresh guard. So for example, in cricket, you could score a double century, and then if you come and play the next ball, you have to take the guard again. Fresh guard. Past history is past history. Past achievement is past achievement. Nobody is going to give you credit because you scored a gold medal in first semester. You have to study in second semester, right? You have to go, work hard, work hard, work hard. Believe me, there is no shortcut to success. The only shortcut to success is to work hard. Work harder, run the treadmill faster. Because everyone is walking faster. Work hard, no other mantra for you. Yeah, you got to be creative. It's not about, when I say work hard, it doesn't mean that, you know, you will take the bag and walk out every day not knowing where you're going. You need to balance out working hard, working smart, working creative, working intelligently. All this needs to kind of come into a Venn diagram, and then all of them should kind of merge. Somebody said, willpower, independent will. Organizations, I will probably go and take a little step back and say, why organizations, some organizations with great ideas succeed and some fail? It's the discrimination to know what is right and what is wrong, and the determination to follow what is right. And also, to go against the common wisdom. A lot of people have succeeded because they were passionate. Somebody said passionate. Passionate about what they did. When you're passionate about what you're doing, you know you're going to win. You look at this India Got Talent. Look at those small kids. How they come and perform. Villages. What is that? So many people would have told them that, you know, you have no choice, nowhere you can reach any of this. But how do they reach there? What do I learn from them? Persistence. Independent will to go against common wisdom. I think it is extremely important as leaders, once you've got an idea, once you know this is what you're going to become, honestly, I would urge you, so many people in your batchmates can say, no, this company is bad, you should not go here, you should not go there, you know, this is the only job, marketing, we should only go for marketing. There are, if I will give you some numbers, if there are 1,000 jobs for sales and marketing, 990 of them are for sales. 10 of them are for marketing. And what kind of jobs do you get in marketing? They are not real marketing jobs, market research, PR. So to get a real marketing job, you should be extremely lucky. Otherwise, you don't get it in the campus. So get your expectations right. You have to go against common wisdom. I am a marketing student. I want to become a brand manager. This is what I have seen for the last 20 years. Every management student wants to become a brand manager. Then though I should have 2 lakh brands. For example, if I look at 4,000 people we have in our company, we have 10 brands. The entire marketing team is just 13 people. Just 13 people manage the entire brand management, even including the CMO. Right, so get the right expectations. Know that sales is not a bad job. There are myths, girls cannot do sales. I mean, in my office, girls are the ones who actually do exceedingly well in sales. Because our sales is not credit card sale. Our sales is not prepaid card sale. Our sales is not shampoo sale, or a HLL, or a Procter & Gamble, or Rexona, or, you know, going and talking to retail vendors and selling. That's a difficult sales job. But we are talking to HR heads. We are talking to intellectuals. We are talking to, you know, if I come to an institute, and if somebody has to sell a recruitment solution to Balaji Society, whom will he meet? Think about it. If I go to a startup to sell a recruitment solution, whom will I talk to? I will talk to a CEO, because it's a tech-enabled recruitment solution. Unfortunately, people think sales means you have to lie, you have to misrepresent facts, girls cannot work in sales. Please get all these myths out. Let me give you another interesting statistic. 70% of all the Fortune 500 company CEOs are from sales. Go and do this research. They all started their career in sales. You get revenue. In our organization, the sales guys get fantastic increments year on year, year on year, year on year. So, go against the common wisdom. Challenge assumptions. Have an independent will. Prove that whatever stream that you take, you will be passionately going behind it and achieving success. Today, what is called risk, what earlier we used to be calling mistake, today they call it risk take. If you take a risk and you fail, you learn. It's not a mistake. But are you taking informed decisions? Are you taking decisions basis analytics, basis knowledge, basis homework? That's important. So when you, 3 months from now, 6 months from now, get into campus recruitment season, please pick and choose. Any of you feeling sleepy, get out and fresh yourself and come back. It's okay. It's time to get freshened up. So it's important to get the right expectation, get the right knowledge, build relationships. Extremely important again. When I look at some of our internal examples, people have left, HR heads have moved 5 companies, but my same account manager keeps going and meeting them. And in multiple organizations, they come back and help us, you know, get an entry for Naukri in those organizations. So to me, the relationships that you build now, the relationship that you have built earlier in your school, in your college, build those relationships. To me, a success, a lot depends on building those relationships. For example, when I left Xerox and when I joined Naukri, many of my friends in Xerox helped me in putting up some systems and processes. I always used to go back to them and say, hey, fine, I have a problem here. How do you think you will handle this in Xerox? How do you think you will handle this? I mean, those guys come and give me very practical suggestions. Let me tell you, more often than not, people sitting in this row today, let me take this example. 10 years from now, each one of you will be in different companies, doing extremely well for yourself. But you know, how can you go and bounce an idea to somebody who's at your peer level in an organization? You could actually go and bounce back ideas to your classmates, your batchmates, your schoolmates. I still do that. I still go back to my school alumni. And recently, we had an alumni in Goa with our MBA group. All these guys are in some great organization. What happened in that alumni meet in 2.5 days? We had so many ideas that we got out. I was surprised that for some of my problems in my office, these guys had different solutions because they are all managing different businesses. So to me, nurture those relationships. That's why you have these technologies which could help. You could use those technologies like Facebook and LinkedIn productively for sharing information, knowledge information, and do not use it for wrong purposes. Build relationship with customers, with peers, with bosses, subordinates. All, you know, I hope all of you would have heard this. Everything goes well. You would rather do business with people whom you want to work with, who are comfortable with you, right? You can actually win an argument and lose a customer. I would rather say lose an argument, doesn't matter, but win relationships. You don't know, there is nothing called enemy in business. Even competitors today collaborate. Reliance and Airtel share actually networks. They are competitors. Competitors compete professionally, but they also work together. So it's important to kind of build relationships with your peers. Connect. Connect with people. Help. Genuine interest. For example, there are times where if anyone else could have sent this mail to ask me to come today, I would have said no. It's Bala sir's mail, I came, because there is some connect that I have with him. There are times, these are relationships that you build. Very, very significant relationships. Connect with people, connect with customers, connect with friends, connect with, you know, why I say this is important, because more often than not, we used to actually invite our ex-employees once a year. Sometimes I feel that when these guys come in and speak to our existing employees and they say, yeah, I made a big mistake of leaving this company. And then the existing people realize, oh my God, I thought you were doing extremely well in this company. Yeah, that's for others' sake, but I know what I'm missing. There are people who have come and cried to us and said, Suresh, I made a big mistake by leaving this company. I went for salary at that point of time, but today I realize what has happened to my people. I mean, sometimes when you are sitting in this campus, you won't know the value of this campus. You may be thinking about discipline and some of the stuff that you go through here, and you know, it may be, sometimes it could be like, is it too much for me? But when you come out and meet other MBA students, other college students, and then look at, oh my God, I studied in an institute where at 4:30 I'm supposed to get up and do pranayama, yoga, and all that stuff. That was the institute that I studied. And I used to feel, what is this? But today I know why they did what they did. And why am I able to be, you know, so energetic, despite the fact that I had a flight at 4 o'clock in the morning and I travel like 15 days a month. That's the need of the hour today. Need of the hour today is, if you are a, you know, top management guy, you need to travel. And when you travel, you have to be energetic till the last minute. I can't doze off. You can. I can't. So connect with people. Learn. Under-promise, over-deliver. This is something extremely important for all of you. Right from today, if you say you will meet a person at 5 o'clock, ensure that .455 you are there. If you say you will submit an assignment at 11 o'clock, 10:55 that should be there with the prof. These are habits. Habits don't die hard. Let me tell you, more often than not, when people write to me saying, sir, glad meeting you, I will call you on so-and-so date at so-and-so time, I actually expect that call coming. But in 99% of the cases, people don't. They don't call. You tell customers after a meeting, I will send a proposal by tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, sir. You forget the proposal. What is the reputation that you have? How many of us do this? If you are one who has such brand, persona, what do you call as persona? What is your persona? What people speak about you in your absence is what is called persona. They all talk very sweet things to you. And they say, yeah. How many friends actually do you have? If you do a 360-degree feedback with all your friends, do that exercise. I went through a leadership program in ISB. All vice presidents, senior vice presidents, EVPs, all of them were there in that. And you know what? Some of them literally, profusely, they were crying. Some of the top brands in the country. Because their own team members have given feedback about them, which they could not believe they were. They were thinking that, you know, they were along with the, they were always with the team. Somebody told them, saying that, you know, you are a AC room manager. You sit in the AC room, you don't even come out to the field, you don't even know what we are supposed to do, you just ask for numbers, you are an Excel sheet manager. Ask for Excel sheets, ask for PowerPoints. But you don't actually come and play. What is the difference between a Mahendra Singh Dhoni when he came to Chandigarh and in the Pakistan-India semifinals, I think he promoted himself. Came on, I think, first down or second down and scored to win the match. Leadership is all about putting yourself ahead of the team. When it is required, drench yourself. Go all out and show how it is different. So when it comes to promising and delivering, you should have, if I go and ask five people who know you very well, what do they speak about you? In your absence. That's called perception. And today, brands actually are managed by perceptions and not by reality. What you perceive about the brand is more important than actually what the brand thinks about itself. So this, in my opinion, is an extremely critical criteria for success. Success for brands, success for institutions, success for organizations, and success for human beings. You want to succeed, ensure that you meet your commitment. And to me, if commitments are not being met, four quarters I see people doing, then I call them PowerPoint managers. They can only say PowerPoint. They can't actually get results done. Are you a PowerPoint manager or are you a execution manager? Right? So execution managers don't give excuses. Managers actually don't give excuses. Damagers give excuses. So think whether you are a manager or a damager. Reputations are not built on what you say. They are built on what you deliver. Again, be clear about it. Whatever I am telling you today, rewind after 20 years. You will be standing in this forum, in this place, and giving lectures to your students, your juniors. At that point of time, I am sure one of these statements will come to your mind. Willingness to take additional responsibility. Take on the additional responsibility. For example, this girl took the responsibility, Piyush took the responsibility, they missed their lunch because of that today. For whatever reasons, when you take additional responsibility, it calls for that extra effort. 1.5 hours travel from the institute to airport, then coming back. In the process, you have to engage with a stranger. You don't even know whom you're going to engage with. But that's a risk-taking ability. How many of you raise your hands when I asked you? It was a non-damaging question. I didn't even ask you anything about your subject. I asked you, how did you feel? I had to prompt you even 3 times to get one hand going up. How will you take additional responsibility? In my organization, when I promote people who do targets, in ranking system, we call them 3 out of 5. If you meet your targets, you get 3 out of 5. You don't get 5 out of 5. 5 out of 5 is given, 3 out of 5 is meeting expectation. 4 out of 5 is exceeding expectation. 5 out of 5 is exceeding expectation to the next level. So, in the way our HR performance appraisal systems are driven, is meeting a target is 3 out of 5. So, if you say that you come to college, study, do your projects, submit assignments and go, to me you are a 3 out of 5. Did you take extra initiative? Did you go to the library? Did you read something more? Did you participate in some quiz? Did you participate in some competition? Were you volunteering for something? I am telling you, these are the learnings which will come very handy, very, very handy, let me tell you. Because you put yourself in uncomfortable zones. And every day in professional organizations, you are put in uncomfortable zones. And you are preparing yourself for that. Let me again and again remind you, whenever opportunity knocks at your door, be the one to take it. Raise your hand. Participate in games, sports, dance, music, whatever it is. Learn, go for it. Have the energy, have the passion. Don't be somebody sitting at the last bench and saying, boss, somebody will take me to the job. Somebody will not take you to the job. You have to make it. Internal locus of control, external locus of control. Got it? Internal locus of control is something, somebody who says that, I have it in me. What did we do this exercise in the first? Tell me what time I should stop. Is it time? Internal locus of control, external locus of control. Now, why did I do this exercise and say bring you to the present? Because I said happiness is in your hands. Creating a new present is in your hands. By that exercise, what you did was you were able to recreate that moment when you are extremely happy. And whatever your present situation, that did not exist. You created a new present for yourself just by 75 seconds of exercise. In 75 seconds, if you can recreate a present for yourself, why do you have to come back and say 100 excuses to say why you didn't do this? Rather say one reason why I did it or why I will do it better. Again, take responsibility. Take ownership. Take ownership. This is a big word in corporate. Take ownership. Don't give excuses. We don't have time for excuses. First excuse, okay. Second excuse, okay. Third excuse, fired. Be proactive. Again, you will say, did you have to fly down from Delhi to Pune to say, I have to be proactive? I don't have to. All this is nothing. This is all from Stephen Covey's book, which I have picked up. Many of it is Stephen Covey. Some of it is my own knowledge. Some of it is experience. Many, many times I have seen fight between technology and marketing, fight between technology and product. Several administrators telling me that, you know, marketing did this campaign without telling me. If marketing did this campaign without telling you and you guys are sitting in the same floor, I don't have a problem here. You should work together. You should collaborate. So proactiveness is all about knowing what is likely to happen and being having a plan B in place. If you're proactive, you would know now that, boss, there is a problem. IT services may not hire big time. There is a probability that, you know, in the campus season, we may not get so many good jobs from IT services companies. What is the plan B for me? Do I have a plan B? Do I have a plan C? Or expect that, okay, that Cognizant, that TCS, that Wipro, that Infi, one day will come and hire me. Till that time, I will be jobless. You can have a dream company in mind, but the dream company may not come. But would you lose opportunities? Or would you plunge into action and say, hey, fine, I'll pick up something and I'll work on it? So being proactive is all about ability to understand the plan B. Think win-win. Again, this is not Greek and Latin. No need to come from Delhi to Pune to say this. But still, extremely important. More often than not, there are five teams. I'm not mentioning this institute, but I go back to my engineering college days. Five different groups are formed for a cultural event. So many ego clashes. After all, students in third year engineering, I still remember how many ego clashes, how many differences. Objective end motto is to make that function happen. But will I go and tell this to the principal first? Will I go and tell this? Somebody will do the job. Somebody will take the credit. Somebody will go and tell the principal. And the guy who actually did the job, my God, by the time I did the job, somebody else has gone and told, and the credit is already taken. There are credit-taking managers. These are behaviors. Change that behavior right now. For you to get a 10, somebody else does not need to get a 9. In my organization, everybody can achieve their sales targets because they all work in different accounts, different geographies, different territories. I don't actually have to steal somebody's cake to eat my cake. But this competitive spirit, unfortunately, is not with competition outside, it is competition inside. You may not accept it. I don't want you to accept it. But more often than not, organizations fail because of internal competition than external competition. We all don't unite together. More than two is a crowd. So many competition, internal competition. Please get rid of this. Think win-win. As a manager, as a leader, it is a responsibility to ensure that five fingers are not same. Each one is going to have different egos. But you have to put this together. Subordination of individual interest to general interest. Heard this somewhere? Fayol's 14 principles of management. He spoke about it long back. And it is still relevant today. Subordination of individual interest to general interest. A leader should actually give and give and give credit. Even when he has done something, the leader who actually gives credit is the leader who is respected. How many of you have seen Mahendra Singh Dhoni taking the shield? He will be the last one to come and give the post. He will give it to the newcomers. They will all hold it. He will go and stand behind. That is leadership. That leader who can actually give credit to the team will always be respected. Unfortunately, we have very few such leaders in any organization. So inculcate that. If you are a leader in a cultural committee, if you have five people working with you, try, don't steal ideas. Give credit, participate, make the last guy come to the front. Do all this, you will believe a phenomenal amount of positive energy flowing around. Inculcate. Work on self-development. I have spoken about it a lot. I will still speak about it. We are living in a world where we are running on a treadmill. Technologies, companies become redundant overnight. So you have to constantly unlearn, relearn, invest. There are all kinds of, today Coursera is available. There is so much of online content available. So much of HBR articles are free. Lot of content on HBR is free. Go and apply, read. Let me tell you, keep it as a target that every week you will read one article. Go to YouTube, look for videos. There are so much interesting videos available by experts. My submission to you, if you want to succeed, you have to constantly learn. And learn and also have a 360 degree feedback. Ask your peers as to where do you think, you know, we all know this Johari window, right? Blind spots. Okay, we all don't know where we are actually weak. We think we are good at this, we are good at this, we are good at this. But your peers, in fact, more often than not, my team members tell me that this is your area of improvement. Your wife will tell you. In fact, for me, my blind spot is my wife. She will always tell you, you are useless in this, you are useless in this. Because they live with you. And I go and tell her that, you know, I go and make a presentation to this college. That's fine. But I know you. Right? So the question here is, do you know who are the people who can call a spade a spade? My son will tell me, Papa, you are not good at this. You tell me that we should not speak while we are eating, and you are watching TV and speaking. You tell me that you have a discipline of not attending the phone. We have a discipline at home that we should not look at phone while we have dinner. And I'll be the first one to break that. And he will tell me that you are not doing this. But can a subordinate tell me if I break my rule? He cannot. But who's your actual, you know, this is like this English poetry or prose that we read, you know, this great shirt or great dress or whatever. You know, I think in the 6th standard or 7th standard. I'm not able to get that. It was like the king going emperor's clothes. You know, that blind spot is that emperor's clothes. We all think, because you have arrived at some place, I may still have so many areas on which I am not good at. But I have arrived at some position today. And if I have to go to the next level, I have to know what my blind spots are. Please work on your blind spots. And these blind spots, in psychology, these are derailers on behavior. Certain behaviors are derailers. And they will kill you to the last minute. Keep working on it. Work as if you own the company. When you are in a hostel, switch off lights. Switch off, don't waste water. These small things that you learn, don't throw paper on the roads. Small, small things. Work as if you own the company. I mean, I learned it from my ex-CFO. He was eligible to go business class. And he will say, this is only this distance. I will only go economy. I said, you are eligible. He said, what is eligibility? This is our company, our money. Why will I waste my money? And personally, he will go business class because he was worth so many crores. So there I learned a lesson that as a leader, you have to walk the talk. You have to set it. And because he used to fly economy, all of us are forced to fly economy because the CFO is flying economy. And I will also, okay, now from now onwards, I will also fly economy. In some sense, he was building in that discipline. That, you know, work as if you own the company. Work as if you own the college. Work as if you own the house. At home, when you are not there, you switch off the AC. But why can't you replicate this in the college? It is not somebody else's money, right? Again, think about it. Very, very powerful points. So let me summarize with these few points, and I would be more than happy if I have a few questions, which I can take depending on the time available. Successful people, successful leaders, successful organizations. And I would all call of you as budding leaders are successful because you have strong and independent will, you work hard, you have a great goal, you put things first, you build relationships, connect with people, you're proactive, under-promise, over-deliver, think win-win, spend time on self-development, always take additional responsibility, look for opportunities where you can show your skills, work as if you own the company. Thank you so much.
The seminar is now open for questions.
Any questions?
Sir, talking about networking, so it's very important for a marketer to network.
Yes.
And there are a lot of times that you build a network and you move on, but the building relationship part still remains. So as a manager, how should we work upon building relationships?
Build relationships with people who mean
as
business.
In networking. So I met a manager, we are a network now, and we moved on to another business. But in the gap period, there was no communication. So the network or the build relationship subsides. How can we sustain the relationship?
Use technology. Create WhatsApp groups. What do we do today?
Okay.
I mean, I'm able to engage with even the last mile guy in my company by creating multiple WhatsApp groups. I have a product group. I have a management trainee group. I have a technology group. So let's say, for example, you want to engage with your classmates in school. I have a schoolmate group. I have an engineering group. I have an MBA group. I have a Wharton group. I have an ISB group. I'm not still, you know, contributing every day, but somebody is contributing. See, technology today has provided huge opportunity for you. Google can create Google circles. See, what you should do, if you really want to network, in my opinion, should be to identify 10 or 15 groups. One could be your family, one could be your, you know, you could get ideas from your family members. You could get ideas from anybody. But the question is, yes, I agree that you may not be able to always keep in touch. Keep in touch is not about taking a phone call and speaking. Okay. Keep in touch could also be that, you know, once in a while you write an SMS to them. Create group of like-minded people. And use those platforms to, you know, like for example, I have a fitness group. I have a investment group. In my own MBA group, I have 5 groups. Because all of them are not converging on same ideas. One guy, you know, we all have a looking at investment options. So we have an investment group. And I have a travel group. These people keep saying that I went for this trekking, I went for that trekking, I went for this. So I'm in all the groups, I can contribute, I can read. But the question is, you want to be a moderator and you want to kind of create, you should have 4 or 5 moderators who can moderate. See, it is not going to be easy. Right? If I look at my phone now, there could be some, you know, 250 groups. I don't know how many groups I have. And I don't know how many groups I have in LinkedIn. How many groups I have in Google. Am I able to go and engage everywhere? Maybe on a Saturday, Sunday, when I get time, I do. But the question is, you are creating forums for sharing ideas. And you may not be able to contribute. Maybe you can read. Got it? You have to spend time. See, this, for example, some of the good, you know, links that I get for reading, that comes from my classmates in the US. They keep posting this article, that article. And suddenly I realize, boss, I need to get something. I write to them saying that I'm going to make a presentation on this topic. Do you have anything which you can share? Ready-made, tuck. 10 links will come to me. I'm done. And these are who? They are not your competitors. They are classmates. Each one of them working in different organizations at senior levels. They get this kind of information so much. I am today telling you, technology has taken you to a different leap where there is so much of information out, download. But only thing is, you got to prioritize. Let me, it's not difficult. I am telling you, I have an ISB group, I have a Wharton group, I have a management group, and I'm able to go and at least once in a while meet them also. For example, if I'm traveling to Pune, my guys in Pune know that I'm here. I already put that I'm in Pune today. But I'm not able to meet them, but they know that Suresh is in Pune. So take an effort. It obviously, boss, you work hard. Right? No shortcut to success. You have to work hard. You want to be a winner, you have to work 18 hours, 17 hours, 16 hours, 15 hours. No shortcut. Take half a day on a Saturday, clean up some stuff, read. Yeah, I'm telling you one more, work-life balance. My wife will not like me if I go back to home at 6:30 every day and say, boss, I'm spending at home. I will not be able to take you for a holiday. I will have only normal car. I cannot upgrade. Your family needs money. Your family needs position. She is very happy to go and tell 10 people that, you know, my husband went to Wharton. She is not worried about missing me for 15 days. She is happy to go and put in our Facebook that my husband is in Wharton. Right? I am telling you, that is the, my son is proud that my father is this. And for that, he has to miss me. He will say, fine, you go. Work hard.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Any more questions?
Sir, I'm Bhagyashree from BIMM, Systems Batch. Sir, I too agree that the technology is bringing everything on finger, but the day is not too far where in every field, AI will be in boom.
Artificial intelligence.
Yes. And with increase in automation, I have read an article that automation is replacing humans with robots. So what's your take on this? And the second part is, what skills we should inculcate in us to match with the trend?
Okay. I will go back to 1999, December 31st. I was in Xerox. People said, Y2K, all systems are going to crash. And you know, I think those days, people who all went to, you know, even who could spell Unix, people who could spell Java, proper, you know, half-hearted people who also got jobs. So people used to say that because of internet, all the click and mortar businesses are going to close down. Because of e-commerce, all the retail stores are going to, you know, fall down. I mean, today I can tell you, come to Noida, there is a new mall which has come, DLF mall. When I go there, I don't get place to even sit and have dinner, lunch. So crowded that mall is. Has Amazon made any difference to me? To the malls? Has Flipkart made any difference? They may be, but there is, I think, potential for everybody. Artificial intelligence will make your life much more easier. Mobile phones, I mean, I was talking to you, right? 2001 to 2010, it is internet. 2010 to 2020, it is mobile. 2020 to 2030, it is IoT, Internet of Things. Apps, I mean, do you think Make My Trip has made any difference to Jet Airways? In fact, it has actually helped them as an aggregator. There is some site called Indeed.com, which actually aggregates jobs. Is this a competition for me? They help me. Sometimes, you know, human mind does not work on present. Do not really too much, will AI do this to me? Will that do this to me? Yeah, technology will do something to you, but what you have today is to focus on what you can do today. Anticipate, yes, you can anticipate. To some extent, you cannot even anticipate what is going to happen. So my suggestion to you is, yes, there will be. Can AI be, if you think AI is going to make a difference to you, then learn AI. Become an artificial intelligence expert. There could be companies around artificial intelligence. You may be thinking today that, you know, IT services companies are going to, you know, reduce hiring because of technology and because of automation. Maybe that could, that's a temporary transition period. Post which, again, there could be, you know, lot more which could come because of automation. New jobs could be created elsewhere. So I don't think we should anticipate too much about what may happen 10 years from now and worry about it. Think about the opportunity that it creates. Sometimes, you know, challenge and opportunity are two sides of the coin. Which side you see is what it is. Thank you. Thank you so much. All the best.
Facing us with the reality that mere functional knowledge will help a person only to enter an organization, but possessing qualities like focus, good decision making, and discipline will help the person grow in the organization.
Also knowing the purpose of our goals, allocating our activities into urgent and important activities, importance of building healthy relationship, connecting with people, and self-development was indeed a well-designed interaction. Thank you, sir. Now, I request Dr. G. Gopalakrishnan, Director of BIM HRD, to present a memento to our guest.
अभी क्यों लगा रहा है आने दे मैं उसको आने दे मैं लगा रहा हूँ मतलब कि
Thank you, sir.